Hi there folks, in today's demonstration I'm going to show you how I built a solution using the Azure OpenAI service. In this example we have a feedback request email address where I'm going to field various emails that come back from my customers with both compliments and also complaints about the service they've received when ordering items online. So using OpenAI and a prompt that I've built, we'll be able to extract various entities, including the customer order number and the order date, but also we'll prepare a response automatically that we can send instantly via a reply or using responsible AI principles, creating a draft so that the customer service agent can cast an eye over that email before they hit send. So as always, if you haven't already, make sure you like and subscribe. And without further ado, let's jump into the demonstration. So I'm going to kick things off from Azure. And if I jump into the Azure OpenAI, we can see that I already have a service established called AI DemoBird 365. But of course, you could go through the wizard and click on create. If I go into my particular service, there are a couple of areas to be aware of. You have your keys and your endpoints. And it's here that you grab one of the two keys in order to access your API. We also have these deployments, these different models that you can choose from. Again, there is a wizard. I've deployed two of these, the DaVinci model and also the GPT Turbo. But today I'm going to use the DaVinci model. If we jump back onto the overview, there are a few different areas along the bottom here to learn more about OpenAI. Today I'm going to jump into this OpenAI Studio and go into the completions playground. So we'll click on that, jump into our playground, and you can see I've already pre-configured a prompt based on an email being received at a central mailbox. We want to check over the subject and the body of the email and respond to that customer. So with that data that I'm now highlighting, I'm then wanting to extract various entities, including the customer name, the order number, the order date, the sentiment, is it a positive or negative email, and then to generate a response. And if I want to see the potential outcome, if I click on the generate button here, we can see some of the sample data that's been generated based on this object that I've defined. We have the customer name, the order number, the order date, the fact that it's a negative email, and then a nice response back to Dave Smith regarding their order and the fact that they've not yet received their Xbox. Now I'm going to use this data today that's being captured or extracted to one, update a record or insert an item into a SharePoint list, but two, to send an email either instantly or based on responsible AI, create a draft email that potentially a member of staff can cast an eye over, make any necessary changes, and then send the email off to the customer. Now, if I jump across onto my Microsoft Flow, the trigger is all based on when a new email arrives in a shared mailbox. I've created a mailbox based on the alias feedback. And then I use this HTML to text action, two of them, one to convert the subject and the other to convert the body into plain text from HTML. I then have a compose, and within that compose you can see the prompt that I had earlier in that completions playground. I've passed a couple of dynamic values for that subject and that body, and I'm also using UTC now to get the current date. I have a couple of other dynamic values, which includes the from address, which is our customer, and also the to address, which is our incoming feedback email address. And then everything else you see about the prompt is exactly the same. If I now open the HTTP action, you can see one of the endpoint addresses we have here. And this is based on the deployment for the DaVinci model that I've created. And you'll also be able to see this API key, which of course, after this video, I'm going to change. But based on this key, it'll allow me to authenticate with this endpoint here. And then in the body, you can see all the various parameters, including the prompt, which is based on that compose. Now, when that action runs, it obviously generates several choices, and you can see the expression that I have in the compose right now. I'm using the first expression to get the first choice, but at the same time, convert that string into text and then get the text value, and that'll allow me to retrieve back the response from the ChatGPT model. In the create item, and then using the data returned from that composed JSON just above to get the customer name, the order number, and then some logic here to return a null or the order date, if there's a date retrieved or not, and then also the final sentiment value. Now this will of course create a new item. If there was going to be an email chain, you may well want to have some logic in there to update an existing item based on a reply being received to an email. Now I have branching just after that, the first of which is to reply to an email, which is an action that will respond back to an email based on the message ID. And of course that email will go instantly and it will send the response that's generated by our model. But I also have an example of the send an HTTP request, which will allow me to use the Graph API and generate a new draft email. So we'll be able to have a look at both the instant email, but also the output that's generated as a result of creating a draft email. And of course, that draft email will appear in our shared mailbox based on the feedback alias. Now, if I go into my Outlook, I have zero emails in my inbox, but equally, if I go into my feedback shared mailbox, we can see there's nothing in the inbox and absolutely nothing in the drafts. And so what I'll do next is I'll fire up my colleague, Dave, and start sending some emails across for some feedback. But just before I do, let's have a quick look at my SharePoint list. So you can see my SharePoint list here has the customer name, the order number, order date, and sentiment. And at the moment, there are no values in that list. Let's go and bring up Dave. So we're now in Dave's email address or email account, and I'm going to go into new email and send off a few different emails. So the first one is all going to be based on a missing TV remote. And here's some information that I typed earlier. And again, if I paste in that data, we can see that I bought a TV, super fast delivery, which I'm absolutely delighted with, but the remote control is missing. Now, if I type in the feedback address and hit send, that of course is going to trigger that flow, go through the model for ChatGPT, generate a response, create an item in that SharePoint list based on the entities that are extracted, but also send an email response and, for the purposes of demonstrating responsible AI, generating a draft email too. And already we can see our first response. Dear Mr. Smith, we're sorry that the remote control didn't arrive. They'll investigate the issue as soon as possible. A quick summary of what my customer details are, the order date based on that email. Of course, I said it was on the 19th of April. We can see we have that captured in the email, albeit we have 2019. And because it's a positive email, we have a thanks 10 voucher code to give them 10% discount. And I think at this point, it's quite useful to highlight the fact that that date that's been supplied is incorrect. You and I know that, an AI model doesn't. So this is where really the draft feature comes into play, or maybe an approval feature, so that a human is casting an eye over the content that's being generated. I'm going to now send two more different emails. So if I go into new email again, we'll choose that feedback email address. This time it's going to be based on a smashed vase. I'll go and send that one off, and I'll generate another email, again, off to that feedback address, based on where is my order, and I'll paste that email in there. So I bought some sea potatoes for my greenhouse this time round. Here comes my next reply about where my order is and the fact that it's going to be investigated and hopefully sorted within the 3 working days. And then finally, based on that smashed vase email, we can see, again, another ChatGPT generated email. The fact it's obviously very important that we receive a vase in undamaged condition, but the emails also asked us to confirm the order number and the date of purchase. So I'll go ahead and hit reply. Our order number is AB76543, and the order date was the 17th of April. And we'll go ahead and hit send and see what happens next. So we've now got a final reply based on us supplying that order number and the date of purchase, albeit you can see that ChatGPT has not got the context 100%. It's asking again to provide us with the order number and the date of purchase, even though we've already got that information confirmed. And so it would be incredibly important that an end user cast an eye over this reply before it's sent. Maybe there's some work there on my prompt required. So jumping back across onto our SharePoint site or SharePoint list, you can see that I have those entries. We have 2 for the last one, of which the first entity extraction had no order number and order date. But the second one, of course, has that order number and the order date that I've supplied. We have 3 negative sentiments, and obviously the first one was positive, in which case we received that discount code. Jumping back onto Outlook, if I do a quick refresh, which is see, hopefully, some draft emails. So we've got 4. Here we go. We have For each one, the missing TV remote, the draft email address, had I been using the responsible AI, I could have gone in there and changed that to 2023 before the email was sent. Onto this one here, everything looked pretty good, but the one that really wasn't right was the smash vase. Please provide us with the order number. I'd probably change that to say thank you for providing us. Thank you for providing us with your order number and the date of purchase, and say we can look into this further and we'll be in touch. So based on that, I can go ahead and hit the send. And if I bring Dave back up, I can see the new emails come in with those changes that I've made to that draft. Finally, if I jump across onto Power Automate, we can have a quick look at how one of these flow histories have run. We have our HTML to text. You can see the text for the subject line has gone from HTML to plain text. Again, for the body, we have all that lovely HTML, which has been converted into text. We have our prompt, which has, of course, all the various details, including the subject and the body of the email, but also the prompt guidelines and how to format that data. If we go into the HTTP action, we can see the prompt having been sent to the API endpoint, but we can also see the response here. So we have the text. And for those that were wondering why I used the first expression, we can see that choices here is an array. And so I want to get that first object of which I want to get the text value. And by converting that text value, which is currently a string, into JSON by wrapping it in the JSON expression, we can then start querying the data based on those key names. So we jump into that compose. That's exactly what we now have. Based on that expression, we have a lovely object where we can start querying that data by name. You can see we've created the item. And of course, we've either replied to the email instantly or we've sent an HTTP request to the Graph API endpoint to create a draft email. So that marks the end of this demonstration, a quick how to set up OpenAI, get it up and running within Power Automate, a potential use case, some room for improvement with my prompt by the looks of it, but hopefully some ideas to inspire you with the use of ChatGPT. Well, I hope you've enjoyed that. If you haven't already, make sure you like and subscribe, and I hope to see you again sometime soon. Thanks for watching.